Well, and another bit thing about this slide is, number one, like we touched on earlier, it is a very powerful, robust slide out, but there's very, very little maintenance, and I would say none in most cases, just making sure everything's tight. You know, you'll make sure jam nuts tight here. But once this thing's rocking and rolling, you don't have to do anything to it. You might get a squeak here and there, and that's okay. A little bit of dry graphite on the cog track for the cog wheel will usually solve those problems very, very quickly. And I like dry graphite because it doesn't gum up as much as a silicone spray or something along those lines.
How often, Curtis, would you recommend bringing a slide room in if you're going to have it sitting out over the summer? Once a month?
Yeah, I mean, just to get some movement. Obviously, anything that rests for a period of time, it takes on some wear that it wouldn't normally would. So, yeah, getting that thing in motion once a month is ideal. If you're going to leave your coach out for extended periods of time at a campground, for example, I would never leave my slides out like that. Just run them periodically. Or, you know, if you got the ability, go out and visit it, bring the rooms in and out, check it, make sure everything's good. You know, another key thing here is, you know, your wipe seals. These things flip in and out. Sometimes they can get stuck. A lot of times what you find on a slide like a kitchen slide, there's no windows in that. So it doesn't have a texture on that wall. So this flap will actually get stuck. So we had flippers, and you'll see them on the side of our boxes. And the intent is for them to grab this seal and flip it as it's traveling. And then up top, usually there's enough texture with the PVC roof that we use and the rubber we use that it's got enough friction between the two to do that. On a slide out like this with a window, this has enough texture to grab those wipe seals as that room's traveling in and out, and flip this back and forth to create your seal. So making sure those rooms are those seals are flipping up top and on the sides in and out as your room runs inward or outward.
So if you were to ever see a leak occur, one of the first things to check, in your opinion, would be make sure that the seals have fully flipped. If they haven't, you're going to see a seal that is pushed in partially like that.
No, I think since we're talking about seals, is something that people ask about, what's my seal maintenance? And obviously keeping it clean, keeping it free of debris, especially along the top, but also rubbing them down with pledge. It sounds as simple as that. Rub them down with pledge. It'll help keep them pliable. It'll help allow them to flip easier.
And they smell good.
And then they're pleasant smelling as well.
Good smelling seals. There's nothing more important.
That pledge actually comes from the manufacturer. That Boyd is where we get these. And we have a great care guide sheet that I believe it's on our Facebook page or on our website as well. But yeah, just little things like that. Just you got to be careful. Some things can cause some deterioration of these seals. So if you've got a question, and even some of the stuff that are pushed very heavily out there are not ideal for some of these things. And you'll see premature wear and tear. When they get really gummy, they start tearing, start shredding. And over time, you know, they might need a replacement here, especially in very hot climates. I see this, you know, in Arizona, down in Texas, sometimes in Florida, these things will gum up really bad, leave streaks on your box. And a lot of that comes from not necessarily maintaining the way they should be maintained.
One thing I've actually gotten asked a couple times this week was, when I bring my slide box in initially, I hear a sound, I hear a pop, I hear a sound that's happening. If it's standing out for a period of time, we're going to get that seal that's kind of is adhering to the inside of that fascia. It's not uncommon for, as you pull that in, to get some noise out of this general area. Also, as we're starting to slide up, again, these plastic skis are coming up. It is entirely possible and normal for them to make some noise as it comes in. It's not necessarily anything.
And it can be quite loud and alarming if you're not used to it. It's that seal just rolling and finally let loose. One other thing for a pop that I've noticed as well. So, you know, we have a metal pan here. And then over here, we put a coating on our floor that's fairly tacky. It remains that way. And a lot of times when those things settle on that pan and it grabs and you run that room in initially, it's almost, I would say sometimes almost like a gunshot, and it'll pop and you're like, something's wrong here. Honestly, a little bit of baby powder put on that pan will eliminate that as well. So you get some weird noises with a cog driven system that a lot of people get alarmed about, but really a lot of times you don't have much to worry about.
Guys, one thing that I've heard just a few times is, someone's putting down their landing gear and they'll see a slide room start to creep out. I know that the hydraulic system that runs the leveling gear also runs the slide room system. Is there an easy fix for that?
Absolutely. It's a very common, not very common, it's a common issue that people may have. It's very, very easily addressed. It's handled up here where the pump is located. Again, we use one pump for both the slides and for the leveling system, and it's right here. So what you're looking at there is a reservoir with a motor and pump and a hydraulic valve assembly right attached to it. And up top and here, these two items, and down here, these two items are solenoids. They're electrically controlled, but they are hydraulic valves, and they can be adjusted. There is a set screw on the end of it. I'll show you in just a moment on an actual one we pulled off. If you start seeing what Bill described as the slide creeping out as you're operating your hydraulics for your landing gear, or if the hydraulics themselves, the landing gear are dropping, or it's kind of misbehaving in a weird way, the first thing we come to is here. There is, again, this is just one of those
solenoid valve,
just like we showed you in there. There's a 5/32 recessed Allen set screw in here. And the one thing that makes this very different is it's reverse thread. So you would be turning this counterclockwise. And we want you to turn it counterclockwise until it just stops. You're not trying to apply pressure to it. You're just trying to get to a positive stop and then letting go. If that's in too far, it will get bleed by on the solenoid valve, which can cause exactly what Bill was just describing amongst a number of other things. Very, very simple, very accessible in our compartments. And it also solves a lot of the problems.
So that's your simple fix. If you're seeing a little bleed through, putting down your slide room and your slide or your leveling lathe and your slide comes out, that's one of your first steps. A couple of small turns with a 5/32 Allen wrench on these solenoids. That's a great first step. May quite resolve the issue right out of the gates.
Just to stress, just snug. You don't you don't want to overtighten that. You could damage those pretty easily. So making sure just to where you feel resistance, back off, let it go. And that usually fixes the problem. And you know, those come to us like that sometimes. We do it, we try to be very diligent, check them all, but sometimes we miss them. I mean, we're humans here. So one other thing I want to show. So that's where the majority of your solenoids are. You also have one always attached to your off door side leg. It'll be very hard to see. Sorry, other side of the coach. Very hard to see. It's usually buried up in the compartment. It's on the door.
You are absolutely right. I got backwards.
Apparently, we don't know our left or our right, folks, but we're getting there.
Hey, we're learning over here in Indiana. So it's usually on the front side of the leg here. It's going to be very hard to see, but if you reach in, you can feel it, and you can get a hex head or an Allen wrench 5/32 on there.
It's exactly the same valve. It's just in a different location. It's a different location. A total of five that you're going to deal with.
Right. So again, like Bill said, you know, you push a slide, your jacks and a room comes out, you got bleed through somewhere in the system. And like 80 to 90% of the time, it always ends up being just snug that down and it takes care of the problem. And then you can be back in business.
All right, guys, today'd be a great steward of time. We've discussed hydraulic slides, pretty much maintenance free, showed them a little bit of the vertical adjustment should you need it. If you have a little bit of creep from the hydraulic lines, solenoid valves, the 5/32 Allen wrench. So let's talk about the electric Schwintech slides.
Absolutely. So they're pretty, very simple systems. They are basically a column.
So hold that out so we can kind of see it away from the slide room there.
Absolutely. So this is the side. What you're seeing here is this. And basically what it consists of at the top is an encoder motor with a drive shaft, and at each point,
it's going. So this is the motor up top.
Yep, the motor's up top.
Little connection harness.
Yep, that's where it connects to the harness that goes onto the controller. And then in here behind you, you can't see it at the moment, there is a gear.
Which drives this rack right here. You see the gear teeth here. So the gear you can't see there grabs this and rolls the room in and out, both top and bottom. And an axle.
Yep, then there's this axle that comes down to one down here just like it. The room's weight actually rides on these rollers and it rides on these tracks, just like Curtis was showing you. It actually rides on those things to keep them secured.
Yep. So these get mounted, as you can see, to the slide-out box on both sides. And the, you know, there's a lot of math that goes into this. This room size is given to our vendor. They say, okay, here's what you need, and they give us the rack and column, and then we simply apply them. Obviously, applying them very straight, very uniform is very important for us. If they're out at all, you can get some pretty weird activity and behavior.
This is how they arrive to us from Lippert manufacturer. They're held on by these brackets so that we don't time them. They are pre-assembled. We just install them. They're nice and parallel.
And then you remove this.
And then you remove this. And this goes back to Lippert. They send it to the next one.
And there's one on each side. So it's a dual motor system. And they touched on those earlier. So this, the other side of this box also has that. When we're done with that, that box sets in that room. It's this one actually does ride on rollers, unlike the hydraulic flush floor slide outs.
So this actually sits above the floor line, right?
Yes, above the floor line. And the good thing about these is they're extremely lightweight. They're not intrusive. So like a hydraulic ram, you've got rams that go into the chassis cavity. So, you know, that takes up space, valuable space that you can put, you know, holding tanks, things like that. But anyways, up here, we can't obviously shoot anything inside the living room or the, you know, in this case, the front living room. So it's all above floor, everything's self-contained, and it's non-intrusive. So when it's out, everything's out.
In general, we use three rollers on our wider one on a 370 FB. We do use four. It's just to support the wider widths of it.
Right.
And the more weight involved with it. But those columns that we were just talking about attached to the walls right here, that screw directly into frame structure right here. And that is what attaches the slide actually to the coach.
Correct.
And then those motors and those tracks just simply operate it, move it.
And once it's installed, those motors will be at the very top here?
Yeah.
All the way up at the top there, yep.
So, on the inside, you can access. How would you access a motor?
You've actually got a hyperextender room. You got to get to the column. So replacing motors a little different ballgame. We don't see a ton of that. That's a very low failure rate. A lot of the stuff we see troubleshooting-wise is electrical. You've got a problem between that motor and that controller. There's a pinched wire. There's a loose plug, a bad pin in the connector, something along those lines. And the cool thing about the Swintech is they have a controller, which we'll get to and show you where they're located, that tells you what the problem was. If you've got a Swintech room that won't slide, you've got a controller somewhere flashing a code at you that's telling you what's wrong with it. And it could be any number of things. It could be low voltage. It could be a bad motor. It's going to tell you what and where to go to find that problem. And that's why I'm a big fan of Swintech, because they're super easy to work on. And other than the rack, there's very few moving parts, you know, like a manual override on a Swintech slide out. You pull a set screw on the exterior rack, which we can show you over here. So this actually, you disengage that and it disengages the motor, and you could manually move that room in if you were in an emergency situation.
Can you show that again, Chris?
Yeah. So this here, holds the motor in. And if you pull that screw, that'll disengage that motor. Now, you got to do it on both sides if you want to move that room in manually. It takes a couple large men usually to do so. But you can get it in, and then you put them back in, and you lock the room back in place.
To access that, you would need to remove the bulb seal?
The bulb seal, yeah. Which
just slides in that track?
Yep.
And then it'd be available from the outside. So extend the slide room and remove the set screw.
100%. And, you know, if you notice, a lot of the same components are used from a seal standpoint. You got your bulb seal that slides onto a retainer track. So, I mean, it literally goes on. Once it's in place, you know, we cut it to length and we put a set screw at the end here to hold it in tight. We use the same things on both slide out types. Jim might touch on the wiring harnesses. Absolutely. And the controllers. And
so, Jim, in my experience, 8 flashes on the controller is one of the most common. About 80% of the time, 90% of the time, if we get a call, it's getting 8 flashes. Can you give me a little insight on what that means and how what's the first step to troubleshoot that?
Absolutely. We get that happening a lot when people are operating their rooms. It stops, it cocks. They're like, why is it stopping? What's happening? We ask them to go to the controller. In some places on our coaches, they're, depending on the floor plans, they're underneath here.
Usually under the slide out. So
on this,
mounted to the ceiling.
8 feet to the ceiling.
Yeah. And we also have other ones where they're mounted in that same front compartment. In this case, they are. And you could, they're up there on the ceiling. There you go. These guys right here.
Everyone has one.
Absolutely. So each slide has its own controller. And this is where you're going to be seeing the flashing light. In fact, there's a legend here as to what those things mean and what you're looking for. So you're going to have one light flashing 1 or 2. And that will indicate either motor 1 or 2. And then the next thing will be the amount of flashes will give you the code, for example, 1, 2, or 3. And 8 is what Bill was touching on, and that's commonly involved with harnesses, an open or a short in the communication cable between the controller and the motor itself. And it leaves directly here, it's this guy right here, and that runs directly up to the motor. You saw the connector that we showed you on the column outside. It's all it is the harness of these fine wires, and it routes in different locations.
So you just basically, it could boil down to there's one wire harness for the left motor, one wire harness for the right motor.
That's absolutely right.
A It's a straight shot through the floor, up through the sides of the slide.
We've got power on purple in this case and ground on white, and then we have one for each motor, and it goes directly up to those motors. If those wires get damaged, we get situations where we lack communication between the controller and the motor itself, which will cause the motor to stop at times and allow the slide to cock and not go out properly. That is probably our most common.
Yeah, but the good thing about that is the system recognizes that high tension on the one that says, hey, shut me down, don't run me anymore. One other thing I want to touch on is a lot of people know how to manually override one of these, and that's fine if you're in a hot situation. But if you do that and you don't watch what you're doing when you're running that, at that point, when you've overridden this system, it's ignoring all the safety signals that it gets. It will rip itself out of a wall. It'll do some serious damage if you're not very careful. So babying it in if you've got a situation that you can't fix. And a lot of times, like Jim said, you know, you got a communication problem between that controller and that motor. It can be a loose plug. A lot of times I say, hey, pull that plug. Let's get some contact cleaner, spread it. Sometimes just blow it out, putting it back in and reseating it takes care of the problem. Now, if that pops back up, let's dig in a little more. Maybe you've got a harness to replace. So the cool thing about the harness is, I mean, you literally have a wire going from there. It comes up through the floor out here, goes up along the sides, and then plugs into the top motor. So replacing one of these is a very simple thing.
Hey, Curtis, real quick. So what I'm gathering from all this is your first step as an RV owner is basically check two connections at the brain, either in the storage bay or the front compartment, undo those connections, blow them out, reconnect them. And then if that doesn't work, at the two motors, undo those connections, put them back. That would be your first step.
100%.
Very easy DIY.
After going to that controller and seeing what it's reading at you. But yes, for sure. That is the first step.
And probably half the time or more, that takes care of the concern.
More often than not, that takes care of the problem. You pull it, put it back in. I've seen some of the harnesses strung too tight, where it's just kind of at a cock, you know, when it's going into the controller. And it just takes, sometimes you can tell on that a little bit, get a little slack, put it back in, and you're back in business. And usually it takes care of the problem. You never hear about it again. Sometimes it comes back up, and at that point, maybe we have a staple through that. Maybe we've jeopardized the integrity of that wire at some point. And that, you know, requires a harness replacement. The cool thing about a harness replacement, it's pretty easy to do. You can fish one right through. Any owner could do it. So, you know, we might be able to send you one directly, and you swap that out with no problem. You don't have to go, you know, wait periods of time to get those type of things. So,
and please note, we'd never ask a customer to do this.
Absolutely,
but. We just want to make sure that you're empowered and understand how this works. And if it's something comfortable for you, we're happy to talk.
One of the things that we did differently, I think it was your idea, is we mounted those harnesses on the outside of the columns going up the insides of the wall so that they are accessible by techs, by the owner themselves. So they're more readily available as opposed to burying them and making it more challenging.
Yep. And historically, kind of what Jim's touched on is this bulb seal, pretend this is running vertical. A lot of times they hide it behind the bulb seal in this little retainer here. So I'll tell a customer, hey, go find the harness. They're like, I don't know where the harness is at. And you got to pull bulb seal off to get to it. So we're trying to make it a little more serviceable so you can get to it and actually see those plugs.
So at the end of the day, what I'm understanding is these motors limit out. So you really can't hurt them if you're not overriding the system.
Correct.
That's right.
You can push that button until you're blue in the face and you're not going to blow up the motors.
And go into safety mode and say, hey, don't run me anymore. It will go back to where you can run it again. So you can sometimes limp it in. You got to get somewhere. I mean, you can do that. But like I said, just being very careful. If you do manually override it, and it tells you how to do it on that controller, so it's no secret. Just be careful if you do it and make sure you got someone watching it so you don't get it way out of whack, because it will get out of time and then you got a problem.
Can I ask you guys, what does the manufacturer recommend for proper operation of a Swintex light? Do you push and hold the button or do you just push it?
Yeah, I was going to touch on that because that is something that is a very common misconception about being ginger with your switch and releasing it too early. Honestly, you want to press that switch in the direction that you wish to go and hold it until that room stops. And then 3 to 5 seconds afterwards, you're not hurting anything. You'll never hurt anything. Once they amp out, as Bill alluded to, you will no longer be applying current to that, but that will help you get it fully out. If you release it too early, the motors are, they're not fully out. They don't recognize that they're fully out. They haven't amped out and they're going to start becoming out of time.
Yeah. You can almost force them out of time. And to touch on that, it's not going to hurt anything. You got to bump a room out a little bit and bring it back in. But ideally when you're running one of these, you want to get it all the way out, get all the way back in. I've had some customers who've heard horror stories apparently that they run it out. They're like, we can't go back now. We got to go all the way out with it. You can do that. You just, as long as it's in time and it's running smooth, there's nothing wrong with that. Just make sure it's better to run it all the way through that cycle out and that cycle in when you're doing that. And it helps keep it in time. And you can actually hear when you run a room out or in, you can hear when those motors cut off. If you got a motor cutting off a half a second or a second before the other, you've got a timing issue. And there's a real quick and easy, you know, retiming process to kind of sync that room back up.
Can you give me the quick cliff notes on how do you retime?
Yeah, so you bring the Resync. Room in all the way, and then you come out about 6 inches, and then you bring it in, and you listen. You might hear one motor shut off, then the next one a second later. Bring it back out 6 inches, bring it back in, and you'll slowly hear those sync back up. The goal is to get those motors to shut off very close to the same time. It's not always perfect, but within a very small period of time, and that's how you resync those. And like I said, it's just in and out at a 6-inch span, and you'll get it back in time. And sometimes it might take 10 cycles, but because you could get these out of sync. Let's say you got something behind it and you run your slide out and you didn't realize the dog toy was back there and it stopped and that other motor kept going. You put that little bit out of rack and that's how you get it back in time. Bring it in and just keep 6 inches back in, 6 inches back in.
You can tell if you're out of time to some degree, first of all, by what Curtis was saying, is if they're ending at different times. Also, if you notice that one motor is louder than the other, sounds like they're one's whining, working harder than the other one, that's a good opportunity to then resync it, just as Curtis had said.
Well, we appreciate you guys joining us. I think we're probably pretty close on time here. We don't want to go overly long, but thanks for having us. Thanks for being with us and listening.